Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Today's podcast will be Restless Legs: What Has Happened to Dopamine Agonists? Restless leg syndrome is a major disruptor to sleep. The Medical and Scientific Advisory Board of the Restless Leg Syndrome Foundation has produced a number of algorithms over the years to help practitioners in treating this very distressing condition. The most recent algorithm from 2021 caused some consternation, however, as it incorporated a significant change in the recommendations for first-line drug therapy. My guest today is Dr. Michael Silber, professor of neurology at the Mayo Clinic College of Medicine and Science, and a board-certified sleep specialist. Mike, you've led the development of these therapeutic algorithms for many years. The most recent 2021 iteration suggests that dopamine agonists should not, at least for most patients, be the first-line treatment. Could you tell us a bit about why this change?
Yes. Well, the question is, really, where have all the dopamine agonists gone? For listeners who like the 60s folk songs, I might answer, maybe we hope that they have gone to graveyards, every one. Now, obviously, that's not true. The dopamine agonists are still around, and they should still be around, but their role in restless legs has certainly become more limited. So let's go back a little historically and see why that happened. When I personally started treating restless legs, say in the mid-1990s, we were in a desperate state. Almost every patient was on levodopa, and we're experiencing what we now recognize as intense augmentation. Symptoms were getting worse and worse early and early in the day, and there were breakthroughs at night. And patients were in real trouble. And then came the first dopamine agonist that we applied to restless legs. It was pergolide, an ergot agonist, which we no longer use because of heart and respiratory problems. But it was like a miracle. And we really thought everything was solved. This was the end of the road. We had a solution for all restless legs patients. I remember being invited by a patient advocacy organization to join a short symposium on trying to find and delineate what was best for restless legs patients. And about half the people there were sleep neurologists like me. The other half were movement disorder neurologists. And the sleep people said, "We think we've solved it all." And the movement neurologist, I remember it so well, said, "You're going to run into trouble with these dopamine agonists. We've been using them for years already for Parkinson's. I don't know what you're going to run into, but you're going to run into problems." And we said, "No, it's all worked out." And we were wrong, of course. So as time passed, after 5 or 10 years use of it, we realized these patients were running into trouble as well. The symptoms were starting earlier and earlier in the day. They were breaking through at night, and they were spreading to the arms, what we today call augmentation. So there were a few studies on how common this was. There was a study from Hopkins to suggest that as many as 70% of patients on predominantly pramipexole developed this over 10 years. We looked at it at Mayo ourselves, slightly lower figure. It was about 42% over 10 years. The discrepancy is probably due to different definitions. And then there was a study also on the rotigotine patch in Europe, which suggested, using about the same definition, about a 36% risk over 5 years, but perhaps less severe than with the oral agents. These are big numbers. You know, we've all got patients who've been 10 or 15 or more years on these drugs with no problems whatsoever, stable dose, no augmentation. But if somewhere between 40 and 70% are developing augmentation, we're in trouble. And those of you who treat this augmentation know how incredibly difficult it is to treat. We may come to this in another podcast, how to handle it. But it is so devastating, these patients, that this seems a good reason not to consider these to be first-line agents. The other issue is the impulse control disorders, which of course are not specific to restless legs. We see them in Parkinson's disease as well. You know, the sexuality, the gambling, the compulsive shopping, sometimes with devastating consequences. We did a control case study some years ago at Mayo and found that as many as 17% of our patients had developed impulse control disorders. That may be a little high, as at that time we were using higher doses of dopamine agonists, and most of the open label studies in ROS have suggested 6% or so, but that's also not low by any means. So those are the reasons why the latest algorithm says that unless there are contraindications to the alpha-2 delta ligands, also called the gabapentinoids, we should start with them rather than with the dopamine agonists.
Tell us a bit about how you would use the alpha-2 delta ligands or gabapentinoids in practice in managing restless legs, Mike.
So let's say I have a patient with chronic restless legs. You know, we sort of define it as at least 2 or 3 times a week and interfering with sleep and quality of life. So enough that we want to put somebody on a medication every night. So how would I start? Well, we've got 3 drugs, and most neurologists certainly are familiar with at least 2 of the 3 and maybe all 3, and many primary care physicians as well today. And those are, of course, gabapentin, pregabalin, and the prodrug of gabapentin, gabapentin enacarbil. So those are the 3 we have. Now, gabapentin's clearly the cheapest. It's been around the longest. But the problem is its kinetics become non-linear over a dose of about 600 to 900 milligrams. So we really just don't know what's going on in the brain when we give higher doses, which we often need for restless legs. Whereas pregabalin has got very smooth kinetics, and so it's easier that way, but it is more expensive. Gabapentin enacarbil overcomes to a certain extent the pharmacokinetic problems of gabapentin, but there's only really a few doses, start at 300 and then move to 600 milligrams once a day at 5 p.m. If we're going to use pregabalin, for most people, I'll start on a single dose of 75 milligrams an hour before symptoms start, usually before bed, maybe a little earlier, and then build up 150 and eventually to the usual standard dose of 300 milligrams. We can go to 450. And you don't have to use it 3 times a day for restless legs. Once a day is often enough, or at most twice a day, an evening dose and a going to bed dose. And basically, that's how it started. If you're going to use gabapentin, we'll start probably in 300 milligrams and then build slowly up to, say, 900 to 1200 milligrams. As most people know, there's a wide dose range. You know, we can go up to technically 4,800 a day. Very few people tolerate those sort of levels, and you don't really need them in restless legs, usually 900 to 1,200. But we don't really know what we're doing with oral doses above 600. And gabapentin enacarbil, 300 to 600 usually would be how we would do it. So that's how I would start it in terms of dosage and building it up.
So we know that these drugs do not cause augmentation or impulse control disorders, but they certainly have their own set of side effects and contraindications. Could you tell us a bit, Mike, about when you would not use them or what side effects one should look out for when using these drugs?
Yes, a really important question. As I started with, we haven't really thrown all the dopamine agonists into the graveyard. There are contraindications to the alpha-2 delta ligands, especially in older people. The sort of things we worry about are patients with active major depression or at risk from relapses of depression, because these drugs can do that, including some suicidal ideation. Obesity is a problem because they increase weight. Now, it doesn't mean we restrict it in every patient who's got overweight, but this is something we have to think about. Patients who have a neurologic or other disorder that's already giving rise to gait instability, that can be a problem in older people, or with cognitive dysfunction, because that can be a problem in older people. Patients who have a strong history of drug dependency, we might be a little more careful on. You know, I don't think I've ever seen these drugs cause dependency in the sort of population I treat, but it's well reported that there can be a dependence issue with these gabapentinoids or alpha-2 delta ligands. So those are the sort of relative contraindications. None of them are absolute, but those are the situations where I think you just have to think carefully, do we want to start with these drugs? So if we don't, of course, we will start with a dopamine agonist. But if we start with these drugs, what do we monitor for and what do we tell our patients? Well, it's really much the same again. We want to be sure that they are aware that weight can increase, that if they have had a tendency to depression in the past, or even if they haven't, that depression can worsen or occur. Gait instability and dizziness in older people, a strange mental fogging, especially in older people. That's always how they describe it, and often in the morning, and can be quite disabling. And then the other thing, of course, is if they've got any respiratory problems, moderate to severe COPD or untreated sleep apnea, at least in theory, these drugs can worsen breathing, and we just have to be aware of it and monitor for that. Again, not something that I've seen that often in my population of patients. Occasionally, you can get leg edema. You can also get it with a dopamine agonist, so it's not at all specific, but that would be a small minority. So I always monitor for these things. When I see them back, I go through all those things with them carefully, just as I do, of course, with dopamine agonists, their side effects.
So let us consider a patient who's tried alpha-2-delta ligands and they have been either ineffective or led to unacceptable side effects. What precautions would you take if you were now going to try a dopamine agonist? And in particular, which one would you use?
Well, that's such an important question because many of our patients do not tolerate the alpha-2-delta ligands, especially if they're older. And you know, they don't work in every patient. There are good controlled trials of pregabalin and gabapentin in a carbol showing they work. And there's one very interesting big European trial comparing pregabalin to pramipexole. You know, we have so few of those trials which actually compare head-to-head drugs. And this double-blind trial compared 0.5 milligrams pramipexole to 300 milligrams pregabalin. And it showed that the pregabalin was at least as effective as the pramipexole. So we've got good evidence they work, but that doesn't mean they work in every patient. And we do have patients who come back and say, look, I've really tried it, it's not working, or side effects have limited it. So what do I use? Well, my biggest experience is with pramipexole. It came out before ropinirole, so I guess I've just developed more experience with it, but ropinirole is fine as an oral agent. Now, the rotigotine patch, as I said, it probably has about the same risk of augmentation, but the European studies suggest the augmentation when it occurs may be less severe and may not need for the discontinuation of the drug in some patients. The problem is the rotigotine patch is expensive. The company does have a voucher program available for non-government pay patients. But of course, most of our patients are Medicare, and it's very hard to get. I'm not sure what the legal issues are, but the voucher program doesn't usually apply to them, and it's an expensive drug, so that's a very limiting factor in many patients. Can also cause skin reactions. You have to move it from site to site, and if there's skin breakdown, you can't use it. So theoretically, maybe it'd be better to start with rotigotine, but in practice, I think most of us start with the oral agents. And the most important precaution all of us can take to try and prevent augmentation is dosage. And that's to keep the dosage as low as possible and way below the levels that neurologists use to treat Parkinson's. So for pramipexole, I think we should have an almost absolute rule for new patients starting on it that we shouldn't go above 0.5 milligrams total daily dose. So the way I'd started is at 0.125 milligrams, 2 hours before restless legs start, and then we increase every 3 to 5 days by 0.125 milligrams till we get relief or until we get to 0.5 milligrams, and we rarely go above it. For ropinirole, it's really a 4 times dose. It's 4 times weaker in strength. So the equivalent would be 2 milligrams. Now that gets a little complicated because the FDA has approved ropinirole for ROS up to 4 milligrams, but I don't like going above 2 milligrams. And again, for rotigotine, not much above 600 milligram patch. So that's probably the best way of trying to reduce the risk of augmentation. The second precaution I would do is always look at the iron levels. Maybe we'll talk about that in the subsequent podcast about iron, but it's thought that low iron may worsen the risk of augmentation. And the final thing is just ask every return visit, when are the symptoms happening? Are they happening earlier compared to the baseline? Have they spread to the arms, and how are you doing at night? And also, have you had impulse control problems? You know, I've had the experience of telling the patients at the beginning, you know, gambling, shopping, and they look at me, this is the strangest thing they've ever heard, and it is bizarre, isn't it? And they can't believe a drug can do it. And then they come back 9 months later and they don't tell you about it. And I don't know if patients forget, or part of the impulse control issue is that they block out the fact that it's really happening in an organic way. I don't understand it, but many patients who certainly heard it at the beginning may forget to tell you, and then you ask and they start telling you about it, and some of them get into tears about what's happening. So important, every return visit, ask about impulse control problems, because they can be, in some patients, absolutely devastating. Legal problems, bankruptcy, it's a real problem, and we have to ask about it. The other interesting thing for any of you who haven't treated people on impulse control disorders from dopamine agonists is you stop the drug, and within 48 hours, almost inevitably, all those dreadful urges melt away, and the patient cannot believe that, in fact, it goes away quite as quickly as that. But it usually does, unless they had some tendency to it before. So those are the precautions I would take.
Mike, do you feel there is any role for carbidopa levodopa? This is the first-line treatment for Parkinson's disease, but why not in restless legs?
Well, as I mentioned in the beginning, the rate of augmentation there is extremely high, probably over 80%, so high that we don't use it for chronic use at all. It's contraindicated, but I think it still plays a role, and it plays a role in those patients with restless legs who can't go to concerts and plays anymore in the evening, or can't fly on planes. You sometimes see these patients on planes, the minute the seatbelt light goes off, they're up and pacing up and down the aisles, and they haven't got chronic restless legs. It's just precipitated by those very disturbing situations, and taking it infrequently, half an hour before you get on a plane, or just before you go to a concert or a play, it can be absolutely life-transforming. Single tablet of carbidopa levodopa 25/100, that may be all they need for management of their restless legs. And taking it intermittently like that, you really don't have a risk of augmentation. So yes, it has a role, but not for chronic treatment.
This has all been very helpful. What final messages would you like to leave with our listeners, Mike?
Well, thank you, Maithri. The first message would be, again, most patients with restless legs who are starting treatment, we would go for an alpha-2 delta ligand rather than a dopamine agonist because of the risks of augmentation, impulse control disorders, unless there are contraindications. But the dopamine agonists are still available for patients with contraindications to the alpha-2 delta ligands, who fail the alpha-2 delta ligands, or who have side effects on the alpha-2 delta ligands. But we have to monitor those patients very carefully for augmentation and for impulse control disorders.
Thanks very much, Dr. Silber, for this very helpful information for our listeners. Hopefully you found it to be helpful for your practices as well.
We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you.